I believe that she struggles in real life as well.
Yes, I'll tell you guys, Journey is played by Vanessa Bader Kelly. She's an amazing actress, and a lot of Journey was actually pulled from Vanessa's real life. Vanessa and I, we went to college together. I went to Florida A&M, she went to Florida State. So though we were at different institutions, we were right across the tracks, and so we both participated in a bunch of different organizations together. However, when she moved to Los Angeles, even though she had been an actress, you know, since she was 4 years old, she was on the show Kenny and Kel, she moved to LA and she wasn't really booking. She broke up with a guy that she was dating for quite some time, and she would show up to my house and she would spend days on my couch. And I didn't have a ton of experience, you know, dealing with depression, you know, in my real life. However, you know, one of my frat brothers committed suicide in college, and I had, you know, some other family members who, you know, the family, we would say, you know, they're crazy, or it was very clear that they were bipolar.
Like Uncle Pete in the back.
So we never really discussed it, and so I watched Vanessa go through these things, and so when I created Giants, I really wanted to give her story a voice, and I wanted to create a character that I had not seen, you know, in television and film. And so in the first episode, we watched Journey not be able to get out of bed, and as a result of her not being able to just get up and go to work, she loses her job, and as a result of losing her job, she can't pay rent. And then as a result of her not being able to pay rent, we get kicked out of our apartment, and she has to move in with her sister, who thinks her mental illness is an excuse, and that she's being lazy, and that she needs to will herself, you know, to be able to do the things that normal people do, or that Christians do. And she's not able to find that within herself. And so we explore that season one, and in season two, as you'll see, we start to go deeper into what it looks like to struggle with depression as a millennial.
Thank you. And I want you guys feel free to jump in if there's anything that comes to mind that you think is important to add in terms of what James has said. Feel free to jump in. Our next question is for Kerri. Kerri, can you share with us your journey to overall wellness and where has Kerri been?
Ooh, it's so hard to sum up the last 7 years of my life. At the height of my career, which was when Pretty Girl Rock released, 2011, 10, Al Jamal, where's he at? Somewhere around there. When Pretty Girl Rock was at the top of the charts, I was barren. I hope I can do this quickly.
But take your time.
I was bearing the weight of some personal and professional mistakes, and they just weighed so, so, so heavy on my spirit. And I was just not myself. Although I was at the mountaintop of my life, really, the trajectory of my dream, I was at the pinnacle, you know? I was severely unhappy, and then add to that, this is when I decide to jump out of an 11-year, leave an 11-year relationship. Bad decision, bad timing. But it all just kind of spiraled for me and became something I had never been through. I had never recognized myself as a person who can't pick themselves back up. I mean, I was literally on stage crying. I was on tour. I remember being on tour. And
did the people around you kind of know what was going on or have an idea?
I think they knew when the breakup happened. Yes. They knew. Yes. That was clear. I was crying before stage, I was crying on stage, I was crying after stage, I was barely getting my makeup on through the tears, and barely keeping it on through the tears. And I remember just, you know, it was just dark. And so, at the time, I was on a European tour, and it just got to be too much. And
How so, if you don't mind?
I just couldn't handle it. I was sleeping. I was not enjoying the trips or the shows or the fan, the love from the fans. I could not receive anything.
Take your time, sis. I understand. I've been
here. And so I told management that I need a year off. I need a hiatus. I was in that relationship from 17 to 28.
Thank you.
You know, I gotta stay pretty.
That's right, that's right. We got you, girl, we got you.
So, I just asked for a year off, and, you know, my management and just no one understood. Production, you know, Timbaland, this is kind of the moment Timbaland and I's relationship really changed. He didn't understand it. Although, when I first met him, I don't want to tell his story, but he was severely depressed after the death of Aaliyah, obviously.
Yeah, right.
And so he credited me as being part of the reason that he got over his.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, I didn't feel the same understanding from him during his time. And so during that time, I only accepted trips that I felt would be most fulfilling. I only chose that I felt would be most fulfilling. I didn't really do anything in the States. I just, you know, went to Africa, you know, cranked that up, and you know, China and Japan and Thailand and wherever my heart really truly desired to be. And I learned the importance of the word nah.
Yeah.
And I just went on an Eat Pray Love. If life wasn't about music anymore, life wasn't about the charts or watching them, life wasn't about releasing music, shooting videos, writing songs, being in the studio, life was just about survival for me and just trying to find one smile a day if I could.
Did you seek counseling or therapy at some point?
I did. It took me a while to get there, but it was not until the anxiety reached a point. And that, like I said, that was new to me, and I just thought, I grew up in a Christian household, I was like, I'm gonna shake it off, I'm just gonna pray it away, like, what is, you know, this is spiritual. And it can be, but yeah, I have a therapist in LA, I have a therapist in Atlanta, you know what I mean?
Yes, therapist.
I made sure.
I'll be glad for that.
I'm the only one in my family, my friends are pretty, thank you. Yeah, it's probably gonna be tearful. But I don't know many of my peers that actually go to counseling, and I can attest to the fact that it is a process, because it does uproot things that I would have anxiety even going. You know what I mean? It uproots for the sake of healing. So it's a process. It's not that you go and sit there one time and feel good. I wouldn't feel good going or leaving. But,
and some people have to find 2, 3, 4 different therapists till they find the right one.
That's true. One that I have, the one in LA, I can't see him all the time because he's just real, he's a little brutally honest. And I'm not ready for that all the time. I was a little fragile. I'm good now. So I took a hiatus from him and I was like, I'm just going to the one in Atlanta. She's very gentle with me. But we have stuff, you know, we have stuff. And it wasn't until I started to do my work during this process, and I'm trying to wrap it up, wasn't until I started to do my work and realized this is really childhood. This is my inner child really wounded. Yeah. You know what I mean? This is really the trauma.
Say that again. Because that was it for me. Yeah, I was in suicide.
Yeah.
People are like, but you're grown, you're successful. How can you be reliving any of that?
You'd be surprised. Yes. My mother actually is in childcare. She has her master's degree in early childhood psychology. And so she has told us something about how, throughout the years, she's allowed us to understand that even infants have cellular memory. They are being affected even inside the womb.
Wow.
They are being affected by traumas, by sound, they fear, they sense danger. And so, these are things that, as our brain is literally and physically developing, we are internalizing fear and stress and anxiety and danger. The world, when I get out here, it's danger, you know. So, but yeah, literally 7 years of my life have been a battle with depression. And I can't say that I'm all the way clear, but I'm in the clear.
Yes.
You know.
Thank you.